Virginia. Inspiring his forest army by a personal visit, President Roosevelt makes his first tour of the Civilian Conservation Corps camps in the Shenandoah Valley. After inspecting Skyland, the commander-in-chief takes a seat at the head of the table to eat with the boys. And he enjoys every bite of the plain, wholesome food furnished at the camp.
It's very good to be here at these Virginia CCC camps. I wish I could see them all over the country. I hope that all over the country they're in as fine condition as the camps that I've seen today.
Book of Genesis, chapter 47, verses 19 and 20. Wherefore shall we die before thine eyes, both we and our land? Buy us and our land for bread, and we and our land will be servants unto Pharaoh. And give us seeds, that we may live and not die, that the land be not desolate. And Joseph bought all the land of Egypt for Pharaoh, for the Egyptians sold every man his field, because the famine prevailed over them. So the land became Pharaoh's. This passage in Scripture is very appropriate for today's topic. We will be discussing property. Who owns all the property in this country? As was discussed in part one of this video series, I described to you how America is not a capitalist nation. That is not the political and economic philosophy that we follow in this country. For one simple fact, the opposite of a free market system is a planned economy. And there is no doubt that that is exactly what this government has been operating under for the past 90 years. A planned wartime economy operating under a, quote, temporary and, quote, limited emergency. But as we discussed, 90 years is far from temporary and limited. And I find today, July 4th, 2023, very appropriate to have this talk with you. For today, as you all are lighting your fireworks, waving your red, white, and blue, and firing up your barbecues, instead, this day should be a day of remembrance. A day of mourning, really. So-called Independence Day. Our independence is a thing of the past. And the fact that 99.9% of Americans still believe that we are free just goes to prove how effective the propaganda in this country is. And furthermore, just how ignorant we all are. We refuse to read. Instead, we just want to be told by the news, told by whatever feeds we are given on our telephones. We want to be spoon-fed the information instead of digging and seeking the truth. Property and property rights are one of the key elements to our individual freedoms. And if that is taken away, you need to ask yourself, how free am I if I don't own anything? I want to read to you again a small portion from the economic essay titled The Road to Serfdom, written by Friedrich A. Hayek, first published in 1944. Quoting, "What our generation has forgotten is that the system of private property is the most important guarantee of freedom, not only for those who own property, but scarcely less for those who do not. It is only because the control of the means of production is divided among many people acting independently that nobody has complete power over us. That we as individuals, not as a collective, but we as individuals can decide what to do with ourselves. If all the means of production were vested in a single hand, whether it be nominally that of, quote, society or the public, as a whole or that of a dictator, whoever exercises this control has complete power over us." You can also read about the importance of property ownership and individual property rights in regards to freedom. You can read about this in the Federalist Papers. You can read about this in the writings of James Madison. You can also read about this in the early works about the American common law. But what I intend to do for you in this video is first give to you some historical context, not about private property ownership, which prior to March 9th, 1933, was a guarantee of freedom in this country. No, I want to give you historical context to the ideas surrounding what was known as the nationalization of the land. Just like they nationalized the railroads in the 19th century, just like they nationalized all the banks in 1933, they also nationalized all the land. So we need to develop first some historical context before we get into the legal side, until we get into the acts passed by FDR in his first 100 days. The first book I'm going to be quoting from is entitled The Science of Government, Founded on Natural Law, written by another Roosevelt, this man by the name of Clinton Roosevelt, pictured here. Now in this book, Clinton Roosevelt is putting forth a proposal for a planned economy, which is socialist and predates communism, but in many ways is communism before communism. So let's read a little from this book, starting on page 73. We here have the body of science. The next object is to give the spirit and the moving power and render it practical. Our object is to convert to the arts and sciences of peace that system and principle of cooperation now best known in war. For that is, as experience proves, the only practical system of harmonious cooperation. Again, proposing a planned economy using the doctrine of necessity and the war powers. He's asked the question, By what tenure would you hold the soil, the land? The system should rule, and the system should look chiefly to the general good. The soil should be owned as the capital of a stock company is owned, but no one shall vote upon his stock. And the officers shall have the right to pay off the debt at any time. But the holders of the stock shall not have the right to demand payment while the interest continues to be paid. In a word, it should be taken and paid on the same principle that the national debt of England is raised and payable. Question: should not every man have a certain amount of land as his own exclusive property? Answer: any individual might have a site for a house and a garden, and even a farm, where it might be difficult to bring large numbers of labor together, as in some mountainous regions, but where large numbers might congregate, these should labor together under leaders in the fields and in factories under foremen and officers, precisely as soldiers in an army do. Again, this is the science of government founded on natural law, first written by Clinton Roosevelt in 1841, where he is recommending the nationalization of all the soil under a system structured like the military, where every citizen acts like a soldier in the army to work towards the, quote, common good. Now, the time frame that this book was published is significant. First published in 1841, that's about 7 years before Karl Marx and Engels published their Communist Manifesto in London. What's also important to remember is that both Clinton Roosevelt and his Masonic friends, one being Horace Greeley, the newspaper man, both of them, both Greeley and Clinton Roosevelt, were funding the Communist League in London during the time that Marx and Engels wrote the Communist Manifesto. So this is all connected, and it is no mere coincidence that these ideals and these isms interconnect. The next document we will be reading for historical context is a letter written from Karl Marx to President Abraham Lincoln shortly after the end of the Civil War in 1865. The title of this letter is The Nationalization of the Land. Marx writes, "The property in the soil, that original source of all wealth, has become the great problem upon the solution of which depends the future of the working class." While not intending to discuss here all the arguments put forward by the advocates of private property and land, jurists, philosophers, and political economists, we shall only state firstly that they disguise the original fact of conquest under the cloak of natural right. If conquest constituted a natural right on the part of the few, the many have only to gather sufficient strength in order to acquire the natural right of reconquering what has been taken from them. In the progress of history, the conquerors attempt to give a sort of social sanction to their original title derived from brute force. Through the instrumentality of laws imposed by themselves, at last comes the philosopher who declares those laws to imply the universal consent of society. If indeed private property and land is based upon such universal consent, it evidently becomes extinct from the moment the majority of society dissent from warranting it. However, leaving aside so-called rights in property, we affirm that the economical development of society, the increase and concentration of people, the necessity to agriculture of collective and organized labor, as well as machinery and similar contrivances, render the nationalization of land a, quote, social necessity, end quote, against which no amount of talk about the rights of property will avail. Changes dictated by a social necessity are sure to work their way sooner or later because the imperative wants of society must be satisfied, and legislation will always be forced to adapt itself to them. What we require is a daily increasing production whose exigencies cannot be met by allowing a few individuals to regulate it according to their whims and private interests, or to ignorantly exhaust the powers of the soil. All modern methods such as irrigation, drainage, steam plowing, chemical treatment, etc., ought to be applied to agriculture at last. But the scientific knowledge we possess and the technical means of agriculture we command, such as machinery, etc., never can be successfully applied but by cultivating the land on a large scale. Cultivation on a large scale, even under its present capitalist form that degrades the producer himself to a mere beast of burden, has to show results to such superior to the small and piecemeal cultivation. Would it then not, if applied on national dimensions, be sure to give an immense impulse to production? The ever-growing wants of the people on the one side, the ever-increasing price of agricultural products on the other, afford the irrefutable proof that the nationalization of land has become a, quote, social necessity. The diminution of agricultural produce springing from individual abuse ceases to be possible as soon as cultivation is carried on under the control, at the cost, and for the benefit of the nation. Again, this is part of Karl Marx's letter to Abraham Lincoln in 1865 after the end of the Civil War, recommending to Lincoln that Lincoln nationalize all the land for social necessity. The last book we will be reading for our historical context is entitled Progress and Poverty by Henry George. First published in 1879, the copy I'm reading from is from 1926. Now, before reading, I just want to make some mentions. This book, when first published, was extremely popular. Henry George was just a common man. I think he was a newspaper reporter for a while. He was a trader or a merchant for a while. But he was no lawyer. He was no politician. He was not a real educated economist at the time. But nonetheless, this book was extremely popular. Not just here in America, but also in Europe. So popular, in fact, that in 1886, it catapulted Henry George into the labor movements, and he ended up running for mayor of New York City. And another candidate in that 1886 New York City mayor race was none other than a 28-year-old Theodore Roosevelt. So you see, the Roosevelts just keep popping up all over this. Now, Henry George was also advocating land nationalization. But instead of mere confiscation of all the land, he was advocating it through economic rent and what he described as the land value tax, also called the single tax theory. And once this book was published, it sparked all kinds of socialist groups who were advocating this single tax and land value tax. Now let's read from page 403 of this book, Progress and Poverty. It is an axiom of statesmanship, which the successful founders of tyranny have understood and acted upon, that great changes can best be brought about under old forms. We, who would be free men, should heed the same truth. It is the natural method. When nature would make a higher type, she takes a lower one and develops it. This also is the law of social growth. Let us work by it. With the current, we may glide fast and far. Against it, it is hard pulling and slow progress. I do not propose either to purchase or to confiscate private property and land. The first would be unjust, the second needless. Let the individuals who now hold it still retain, if they want to, possession of what they are pleased to call their land. Let them continue to call it their land. Let them buy and sell and bequeath and devise it. We may safely leave them the shell if we take the kernel. It is not necessary to confiscate land. It is only necessary to confiscate rent. Like rent for public uses, is it necessary that the state should bother with the letting of lands and assume the chances of the favoritism, collusion, and corruption this might involve? It is not necessary that any new machinery should be created. The machinery already exists. Instead of extending it, all we have to do is to simplify and reduce it. By leaving the landowners a percentage of rent, which would probably be less than the cost and loss involved in attempting to rent lands through state agency, and by making use of this existing machinery, we may, without jar or shock, assert the common right to land by taking rent for public uses. We already take some rent in taxation. We have only to take some changes in our modes of taxation to take it all. What I therefore propose is a simple yet sovereign remedy which will raise wages, increase the earnings of capital, extirpate pauperism, abolish poverty, give remunerative employment to whoever wishes it, afford free scope to human powers, lessen crime, elevate morals and taste and intelligence, purify government, and carry civilization to yet nobler heights, is to appropriate rent by taxation. In this way, the state may become the universal landlord without calling herself so, and without assuming a single new function. In form, the ownership of land would remain just as now. No owner of land need be dispossessed, and no restriction need be placed upon the amount of land anyone could hold. For, rent being taken by the state in taxes, land, no matter in whose name it stood or in what parcels it was held, would be really common property or public property. And every member of the community would participate in the advantages of its ownership. So what Henry George is advocating in this book is not a universal confiscation of all the land, but no, turning the land into what he refers to as common property, which we would call public property, and then issuing a tax upon all the land. And in so doing, the state would become the universal landlord without having to declare itself as such, which would totally disrupt the economy by all the citizens who suddenly realized that they no longer owned the land that they thought they did. Again, this is Henry George's Progress and Poverty, written in 1879. Now we return to where we left off in part one of this series. When FDR came into office, March 4th, 1933, he declares a bank holiday. He calls Congress to an emergency session. March 9th, 1933, they passed the Emergency Banking Relief Act, which amended the Trading with the Enemy Act, all of which we discussed on part one. But that was only the beginning. The Emergency Banking Relief Act and the amended Trading with the Enemy Act was only the beginning. By the passage of that act, the U.S. government did not confiscate or seize anything. I repeat, they did not confiscate or seize anything. They merely stated into law their intention on what they intended to do. But that act did not in and of itself seize all persons, all places, and all things in this country. And we will get to exactly why that is so. The next really important piece of legislation in regard to property that was passed by FDR is what was known as the Emergency Conservation Work Act, signed into law March 27th, 1933. And here we have this website, ccclegacy.org. With the signing of the Emergency Conservation Work Act, this created what was known as the Civilian Conservation Corps. Now let's read a little bit about the Civilian Conservation Corps. The president wasted no time. He called the 73rd Congress into emergency session on March 9, 1933 to hear and authorize the program. He proposed to recruit thousands of unemployed young men, enroll them in a peacetime army. A peacetime army, as we know, this was an economic war. Enroll them in a peacetime army and send them into battle against destruction and erosion of our natural resources. Remember, at this time, all throughout the central United States, there was an ecological phenomenon known as the Dust Bowl. All right. Before the CCC ended, over 3 million young men engaged in a massive salvage operation described as the most popular experiment in the New Deal. Emergency conservation work legislation passed on March 31, 1933. President Roosevelt promised if granted emergency powers, he would have 250,000 men in camps by the end of July 1933. The speed with which the plan moved through proposal, authorization, implementation, and operation was a miracle of cooperation among all branches and agencies of the federal government. It was a mobilization of men, material, and transportation on a scale never before known in time of peace. As we know, it was not a time of peace. From FDR's inauguration on March 4, 1933, to the induction of the first enrollee on April 7th, only 37 days had elapsed. Now, this peacetime army of FDR's was colloquially known as Roosevelt's Tree Army, also known as Roosevelt's Forest Army, as you may have heard in the introduction to this video. This whole program of the Civilian Conservation Corps was overseen by the military. The volunteer army was commanded by enlisted members of the regular army, officers to be exact, and it was funded by the War Department. As you can see from this document, from the War Department, September 30th, 1933, War Department Regulations, Relief of Unemployment, Civilian Conservation Corps. You can pause this video and you can read these first couple pages here. And number three, it describes the War Department's function. The War Department's function is the acceptance of the unemployment men selected by the Department of Labor or Veterans Administration, their assignment and transportation to reconditioning camps of the Army, their enrollment, their physical conditioning for their future work, their transportation to work locations, either as organized units or as groups of casuals, construction, command, administration, discipline, supply, sanitation, medical care, hospitalization, and welfare of the Civilian Conservation Corps work camps, furnishing work details from the Civilian Conservation Corps to the representatives of the department supervising the assigned tasks. Demobilization is a responsibility of the War Department and will be accomplished in accordance with the regulations issued at the proper time. And on page 13 of this document, where it shows the table of organization, company, Civilian Conservation Corps, not only was this whole program funded by the War Department, it was ran with boots on the ground, officers of the Army, and even in its internal organization, they were divided as an army would be divided into companies, and you can see right here as I've highlighted on this table, platoons, three sections, each of two sections, each of two squads, so in platoons, in squads, and companies, and they had a captain or lieutenant at the head of each company. Now, does that sound like just some peacetime unemployment organization? Or is it truly a volunteer army that FDR raised? It is also extremely important to realize that there were multiple civilian conservation camps set up, multiple, in every one of the 48 states, because at that time, Hawaii and Alaska were not admitted into the Union. So you had this tree army, this volunteer forest army, camped and stationed in every single state of the Union. This, everybody, is when all the land was seized. And if you want to find out when whatever state you're living in was captured and was deemed enemy territory occupied by a volunteer army, then you need to head to ccclegacy.org and you can go to the CCC camps list here. And you can find out exactly when the first camps were built in your state. This, according to the International Law of War, was a military occupation. Now, to better understand this, let's go to the Department of the Army Field Manual, Field Manual 27-10, The Law of Land Warfare. This copy that I'm reading from is from 1956. Let's go down to Section 5, Treatment of Enemy Property. Now, you may ask, well, we're not enemy property. The states weren't enemy property. No, they were. Remember, with the amending of the Trading with the Enemy Act, everyone in this country, every citizen, was labeled an enemy by being a hoarder of gold and silver under the amended Trading with the Enemy Act. So we were economic enemies, and in order to fight the economic emergency, the president was willing to use the same power and use the same actions to meet this emergency as if he was at war. This was precisely what he said in his inaugural address. So in Section 5, Treatment of Enemy Property, we're first going to start down here at point 395, seized property. Valid capture or seizure of property requires both an intent to take such action and a physical act of capture or seizure. The mere presence within occupied territory of property which is subject to appropriation under international law does not operate to vest title thereto in the occupant. So it's two parts. The amended Trading with the Enemy Act, which is the Emergency Banking Relief Act, from March 9, 1933, that was the intent to take such action. It was not the physical act of capture or seizure. It's two parts that had to happen in order for title to vest in the occupant, which would be the federal government and the military, under command of the commander-in-chief, commanding his volunteer army, who took over every state, again, not with arms, not with guns and rifles and bayonets. They took it over with pickaxes, shovels, garden hose. Point 396. Title to captured or seized enemy property. Public property captured or seized from the enemy, as well as private property validly captured on the battlefield and abandoned property, is property of the United States and failure to turn over such property to the proper authorities or disposal thereof for personal profit is a violation of Article 103 of the Uniform Code of Military Justice. Now, let's scroll back up to the beginning of Section 5 here, Treatment of Enemy Property. Point 393, Destruction and Seizure of Property. Point A, Prohibition. It is especially forbidden to destroy or seize the enemy's property, now listen to this, unless such destruction or seizure, which is capture, be imperatively demanded by the necessities of war. By the necessities of war. Remember, we talked about this earlier, the doctrine of necessity, the war powers. It was necessary in order to combat the economic emergency to seize all the land. Point B, occupying power. Any destruction by the occupying power of real or personal property belonging individually or collectively to private persons or to the state or to other public authorities or to social or cooperative organizations is prohibited except where such destruction is rendered absolutely necessary by military operations. Now, again, if it's rendered necessary to the military, they can seize or destroy your property. Point 394, determination whether property is public or private. A, beneficial ownership. Under modern conditions, the distinction between public and private property is not always easy to draw. For the purpose of treatment of property under belligerent occupation, it is often necessary to look beyond strict legal title, which is possession, and to ascertain the character of the property on the basis of the beneficial ownership thereof. Thus, for example, trust funds, pension funds, and bank deposits generated by private persons are not to be regarded as public property simply by reason of their being held by a state-owned bank. B, property of mixed ownership. For the purpose of determining what type of control the occupant may exercise over property by way of confiscation, seizure, requisition, etc., the most cogent evidence of public character is such a complete or partial assumption by the state of the economic risk involved in holding and management of the property in question that the state, rather than private individuals or corporation, would be subjected to a substantial portion of loss were the property to be appropriated for the use of the occupant. Should property which is ostensibly private be subjected to a large measure of governmental control and management or perform functions which are essentially public, these facts would tend to indicate that the property should be regarded in practice as public. As public. Now, what is very crucial in understanding is that prior to the Civilian Conservation Corps, which was really President Roosevelt's volunteer army, prior to their invasion and occupation and confiscation of all land in the 48 states, that property, that land, was considered, majority of it, private property or state-owned property. But that was all seized. Now, what happened? Does all that land remain privately owned by the government? No. What they did was they found a way of making all private land public. Now, how did they do that? In order to understand how they made all this private land that was confiscated, all this private land that was confiscated, that was seized by the commander-in-chief, instead of having to hold on to all this land in the name of the enemy property custodian. Now, we're just dealing with the soil, with the land right now. I'm not talking about your bank accounts, not yet. I'm not talking about all your movable property. I'm strictly talking about the land in all of the 48 states at the time. The way in which they were able to convert all the land from being privately held or state held into all of it being public land was by another piece of New Deal legislation known as the Soil Conservation Act, passed in April of 1935. We read from the history of this act from Natural Resource Conservation Service, nrcs.usda.gov. On April 27, 1935, Congress passed Public Law 74-46, in which it recognized that, quote, the wastage of soil and moisture resources on farm, grazing, and forest lands is a menace to the national welfare, and it directed the Secretary of Agriculture to establish the Soil Conservation Service, the SCS, as a permanent agency in the U.S. Department of Agriculture. The creation of the Soil Conservation Service represented the culmination of the efforts of Hugh Hammond Bennett, quote, father of soil conservation, and the first chief of the SCS to awaken public concern for the problem of soil erosion. Remember, this was during what was known as the Dust Bowl. The Dust Bowl. This is also an example of a problem, reaction, solution. This Hegelian dialectic. This is exactly what was used. With the election of Franklin D. Roosevelt as president in 1932, conservation of soil and water resources became a national priority in the New Deal administration. The National Industrial Recovery Act, Public Law 73-67, passed in June 1933, included funds to fight soil erosion. With this money, the Soil Erosion Service was established in the Department of Interior with Hugh Bennett as chief in September 1933. The Soil Erosion Service established demonstration projects in critically eroded areas across the country to show landowners the benefit of conservation. After 1935, the Soil Conservation Service expanded its soil conservation program nationwide with a several-fold increase in the number of demonstration projects. Labor provided by the Civilian Conservation Corps, the Civil Works Administration, and the Works Progress Administration supported this work. So here again, you have the Soil Conservation Service and the Civilian Conservation Corps working hand-in-hand to, quote, promote soil conservation. Now, this all sounds good. And you may ask, well, Harrison, what does that have to do with the land? Well, let me try to explain. With the passing in 1935, in April of 1935, of the Soil Conservation Act, This act redefined all the soil, not just on farmland, not just on grazing land, all the soil of the country. It redefined it as a vital natural resource. And as a vital natural resource, all vital natural resources fall under what is known as the public trust doctrine, which all of these vital natural resources are then held in trust by the states for a beneficiary. But the real question is, who is beneficiary? Is it you, the U.S. citizen? No, you're just the trustee. Who is the beneficiary? Well, the beneficiary is the commander-in-chief, the president, with his broad sweeping authority. The president, as the economic dictator, he is the beneficiary of the public trust, in which all the soil is being held for the public, quote unquote. Now, you may say, Harrison, you are reaching. Where did you get that idea? We will now be reading from the subcommittee of the Committee on the Public Lands in the House of Representatives, the 74th Congress, first session. This was between March 20th to March 25th, 1935, on the Soil Erosion Program. Now, we will be reading from the statement of Rufus G. Poole, who was Assistant Solicitor in the Department of the Interior, which was when this Soil Conservation Service was first put into place. It was under the Department of Interior and then later got moved to the Department of Agriculture. So here you have a lawyer in the Department of Interior who is testifying before this House Committee on Soil Erosion. And on page 81, as he's giving his statement, he says the following. Furthermore, in the aggregate, the interest of the nation in controlling erosion far exceeds that of a private landowner. An individual may destroy his land, move away, obtain a job somewhere else, accumulate capital, and purchase new land. For the nation, land destroyed is land gone forever. I perhaps should point out that there is a growing legal theory in this country that is in contradistinction to the common law doctrine that a landowner can do anything that he wishes to do with his land, that he can devote it to any purpose or any use. Mr. Lemke. There were some limitations on that. Mr. Poole. Yes, but under the old common law doctrine, those limitations were certainly few. If the owner used his land in a manner that did not injuriously affect the use of another's land. Now listen to this next statement very closely. Now, the new theory is to the effect that a landowner, from the standpoint of the nation, is no more than a life tenant. A life tenant, not an owner, a life tenant. And that he should leave his land in no worse condition than that in which he takes it. Otherwise, you might have a population in a particular community ultimately stranded without land resources, again talking about the soil, upon which to make a living. Mr. Lemke, may I ask you a question? Mr. Poole, surely. Mr. Lemke, are you a believer in the single tax theory? The theory that the use and occupation is all that the present generation or any person has in land. Mr. Poole, I have never advocated it. Mr. Lemke, I have no objection to it, but I was just wondering. Again, the single tax theory of Henry George, which we discussed earlier in this episode. The new theory that Mr. Poole is describing is that the landowner, from the standpoint of a nation, is no more than a life tenant. That would make the federal government the universal landlord, just as what was described by Henry George. No wonder Representative Lemke here is asking Mr. Poole if he is a believer in the single tax theory, because that is exactly what is being described. On page 88, still, during this same committee hearing, Mr. Lemke, all I have said has no connection with the Department of Interior because I have not been sufficiently in contact with that department. But I only speak from my association in contact with other departments, which I know are going under the fire, and they will be seriously under fire in 1936. What I am urging is that we should not upset the whole apple cart by going too far, because I am for this program. I realize, as well as I think any member does, the necessity for a program for future generations, but it must be worked out in conjunction with the states, because you cannot go faster than the people are ready to let you go. I think we can get together very nicely on this bill and make a good bill out of it before we get through with it. Mrs. Greenway, Mr. Chairman, I feel that if this matter is approached and presented in the right way, you will have 100% cooperation from everybody whose land is involved, no matter under what category. I think you have got to be awfully careful that these sensitive people are not made to feel that they are being socialized in any way. See, these congressmen knew exactly what was going on. They understood what was at stake with the passing of this Soil Conservation Act in 1935. And during these committees' hearings, it is discussed. All the land was made public by the federal government by the passage of this Soil Conservation Act, getting a vested interest in all the soil, as the soil is now defined as a vital natural resource, and therefore making it a part of the public trust to be held by the states for the benefit of the commander-in-chief. What I have described to you is how the states were put into subjection by the federal government. It was not just the passing of the Emergency Banking Relief Act on March 9, 1933. Anyone who tells you that is grossly oversimplifying the truth to your own detriment. Now, unfortunately, this madness does not stop there. This is only describing the property and all the land. And who owns what? And who owns who? Reading again from the book, competing philosophies in American political economics. I will be quoting now from Carl F. Christ, who was a professor of economics at Johns Hopkins University. This is an excerpt from The Relationship of Prices to Economic Stability and Growth from the 85th Congress, Second Session, Washington, D.C., Government Printing Office, 1958. This essay that he submitted to Congress in 1958 is called The Competitive Market and Optimal Allocative Efficiency. It's just one sentence. Under the heading, Conditions for an Optimal Allocation of Resources Under Private Property and Free Contract. Letter F. The institution of private property and free contract, as we know it, is modified to permit individuals to sell or mortgage their persons in return for present and future benefits. Now, in order to understand what I just read you, you're going to have to tune in for part 3. Until next time, God bless.